go to the gallows, which is life and mother, as you would desire it, and as morality should have it. All the actors are members of my brotherhood of beggars and sisterhood of honest callers. Allow me to introduce myself, sir.
It is an honour to meet you. I am the director of your piece, and let me share with you my vision for the production. First of all, of course, it will be sung in Italian, with the words scrolling across the top of the stage, as is the fashion in our modern opera houses. The other thing, of course, is we should dress it in a modern dress, and we will have all kinds of special effects, such as strobe lighting, such as smoke machines, rain machines, wind machines, and of course, a falling chandelier to thrill the audiences.
Oh no, sir. This is not what I read. I will have none of this fancy fashioning. Come,
let me show you my play as I intended. See, here come my whores and highwaymen. Let the play begin.
Beggars are accompanying on scene.
Of life, each neighbour abuses his brother, or in rogue they call husband and wife, all professions be rogue one another. The priest or the lawyer a cheat, the lawyer be knaves the divine, and the statesman, because he's so great, thinks his trade as honest as mine.
Oh! Mary Mole has sent word that her trial is this afternoon, and she is hoping that you will organise matters to get her off.
Why? She can plead her belly. To my knowledge, she has taken care of that. But as the wench is very active and profitable, you can tell her that I'll arrange to have the evidence solved. Oh, and let Betty Slime know that I will save her from transportation to the colonies, for I can get more by her staying in England.
Betty has brought more goods into our store this year than any five of the gang. In truth, it would be a pity to lose such a good worker.
I love to let the women escape. A good sportsman always lets the end partridges fly free, rather than shoot them. For our sport depends upon it.
Without dispute, she is a fine woman. It is to her I am obliged for my education. She has brought more young ones to our business than had lost to the gambling tables. This woman that seduces all mankind. By her we first were taught the wheedling art. Her very eyes can cheat when most she's kind. Us of our money with our hearts. This woman that seduces all mankind. By her we first were taught the wheedling art. Her very eyes can cheat when most she's kind. She tricks us of our money with our hearts. By her like wolves at night, we roam for prey and practice every fraud to bribe her charms. For suits of love like law are won by pay, and beauty must be fed to our arms. For like wolves by night, we run for prey and practice every fraud to bribe her charms. For suits of love like law are won by pay, and beauty must be fed to our arms.
Make haste to Newgate Prison, boy, and let my friends know what I intend.
I am away. It is a pleasure to be the messenger of comfort.
But it's now high time. I look for a decent execution for the next court sentence. My accounts are a little short, and I need the £40. I hate a lazy rogue by whom I can get nothing until he's hanged. Crook-fingered Jack, year and a half in my service, 2, 3, 4 gold watches, and 7 silver ones. 16 snuff boxes, 5 of them pure gold. Mighty light-fingered fella.
You're welcome.
A very large sheet of broadcloth, slightly soiled. 6 shirts, heavily soiled. And 6 handkerchiefs, thankfully pristine. George of the Dragon, alias the Great Clive. He's going off at the next sentence. The villain hath the impudence to work as a businessman, which he calls an honest trade. Matt of the Mint, promising, sturdy fella, diligent in his way, somewhat bold and brassy, but may gain public confidence if he's not cut short by Royal Commission. Robin of Bagshot, alias Bob Booty.
What of Bob Booty, Osmond? I owe him nothing bad for the time I live. No, my dear, he's one of my favourites. It was he that gave me this ring.
I put his name down to be watched, that's all, my dear. He spends his time among women. When his money is gone, one or the other will have him hanged for the reward. And there's £40 lost to us forever.
You know me, dear. I never meddle in the matter of death. I always leave those affairs to you. Women, indeed, are bad judges in these cases, for they are so partial to the brain that they think every bad answer that goes to the gallows.
Thank you.
Now, my lad, do not tell me a lie, for you know I ain't a liar.
I don't know.
Can you support the expense of our husband, Ussy? His gambling, drinking, and whoring? Have you enough money to carry on the daily quarrels between man and wife about who shall squander the most? If you must be married, could you introduce nobody else but a highwayman? Oh, you foolish tart! You will be as badly used and as much neglected as if you had married a lord.
No, legal regular, my dear. Break the rules of decency. The captain is regarded as a gentleman in his profession. And I know we will either succeed as a highwayman or be hung in the gallows. Either way, a most excellent chances for a wife. Tell me, Ussy, are you ruined or not?
With Polly's beauty, she might have gone off with a man of distinction. Yes, that you might, you patty slut.
What is the witch done? Speak, or I'll squeeze an answer out of you. I believe, wife. Randy, wish you were.
Thank you.
wench to marry without the consent of her parents. Calm yourself. I have a plan to set everything right. Why so melancholy, Polly? Since what is done cannot be undone, we must all endeavour to make the most of it.
Well, Polly, as far as one woman can cope with another, I forgive you. Your father is too fond of you, hussy. Then all my sorrows are at once. A mighty cheerful speech for a wench who is just married.
I hear customers in the next room. Go see what they want. But return as soon as they are gone. Dear wife, don't let your passion run away with your senses. Polly, I grant you, has done a rash thing.
If she only idly aids on the fellow, but it's marriage, husband, that makes it so shameful.
But money, wife, is the true value of a reputation. I tell you, wife, I can twist this match to our advantage.
I understand that Cattle McPhee is worth money to us, but I am concerned that he has two or three wives already. And should he be hanged at the next hearing or two, Polly's inheritance will come into dispute.
That indeed is a thought that deserves consideration. But no lawyers!
Thoughts, Polly. I would not think the match so unreasonable. grieves me to dispose of such a great man. When I consider his personal bravery, his clever strategies, how much we've already made from him, and how much more we may get. I can't bring myself to have a hand in his death. I wish you could have made bold, but...
But in this case of necessity, our lives are in danger.
We must dispense with gratitude and give way to self-interest.
I'll manage Paul.
I'll arrange matters to the other way.
That would be impossible.
doubt it, let me say, me hand.
Oh, how I fear, how I tremble. Go, but when you are free to return, you'll be sure to see me again. Until then, your folly is rich.
Without him, the gang is ruined.
What would you have to do, Captain?
Make me to believe That poisonous snake is sure to kill.
to marry Lockhart's daughter. What is a promise to a woman? Does not a man promise 100 things in marriage that he never means to perform? Women look upon a promise as an excuse for following their own inclination. Yet here must they stay all day long, until I'm hanged, to hear the reproaches of a wench who lays her ruin at my door. To be sure, if her father knows of the matter, I shall have a fine time between now and my execution. Oh, here comes Lucy. I cannot escape. I wish I were deaf.
You base man, you! How can you look me in the face after what has passed between us? See here, you two-tied lowlife, am I forced to bear about the load and the dishonor you have laid upon me? Oh, Maggie, you have robbed me of my future. To see you tortured would give me pleasure.
Have you no heart, no tenderness, my dear Lucy, to see a husband in these circumstances? My dear Lucy, you shall be my wife in whatever manner you please.
Insinuating monster! So you think I know nothing of your affair with Miss Polly Peachum? I can tear your eyes out!
Oh, surely, Lucy, you can't be such a fool as to be jealous of Polly.
You're not married to her, you!
Married? She said that only to anger you and to ruin your opinion of me. It is true, I go to her house, I chat with her, I kiss her, I say a thousand things to her, as all gentlemen do. Then mean nothing to entertain myself. And now the silly strumpet has said that I'm married. Indeed, these violent passions, my dear Lucy, may be of ill consequence to a woman in your condition.
Come, come, Captain. For all your assurances, you know well Miss Polly has taken it out of your power to give me the justice you promised.
A jealous woman believes everything that her passion suggests. To convince you of my sincerity, I shall have no qualms in making you my wife. And I know the consequence of having two at a time.
So you are only to be angered is not enough for the likes of you.
I am ready to give you satisfaction, if there is any in marriage. But what more can a man of honor say?
So then it seems you are not married to Miss Polly?
You know the girl is prodigiously conceited, for no man can say a simple thing to her.
that, like other fine ladies, her vanity makes her think that he's hers forever. And,
the first time I've been alone, must the mother said to her daughter, the English face is smiling, must be spent of ever after. Each time she walks, she fond her throat, thinks every charm was stronger. And at last they made your life with your own, can see you are
consider their own beauty, they are all unreasonable in their demands, for they expect that their lovers should like them as long as they like themselves.
Here comes my father. Now we'll see if you're as good as your word. I'm off to find a chaplain, for I long to be made an honest woman.
In this last affair, Brother Peachum, we are both complicit. You have agreed to go arms with me.
We shall never fall out about the execution. Right, how is last year's account?
Run your eye over that. You'll see it is fair and clearly stated.
These outstanding debts of the government are very hard on us. If people in authority can't pay more for their executions, I shall have to let other rogues live. Besides themselves.
Yes, they treat us with contempt, as if our profession were not reputable.
In one respect, indeed, our professions may be considered dishonest, because, like the great politicians, we encourage those who betray their friends.
Shh! Such language, brother. Learn to be more guarded, I beg you. When you censure the age, be cautious and sage, lest the courtiers offended should be. If you mention vice or pride, 'tis so pat to all the tribe, it cries, that was levelled at me.
Whatever man's estate, you will find him profligate, so be careful who it is you do define. Call your serving waiter or, and the lady from next door will say, sir, did you mention my name?
When you have a loyal friend upon whom you can depend, a friendship that is well and truly tried, beware the hasty slip that could break a partnership and leave us both a dangling side by side.
Proceedings were a little unfair in Ned's case, for he told me in his cell that for the gratuity that he gave, you had promised him a session or two without molestation.
This is the first time my honour has been called into question.
Business is at an end if once we act dishonourably.
He who attacks my honour attacks my profession, and this will not be tolerated.
Open me to speak, I must tell you that Mrs. Coatser charges you with defrauding her of the money owed to her for the apprehension of Mr. Assange. Indeed, brother, we must pay our spies or we shall have no informants.
Are you accusing me of dishonesty, sir? Who has often saved you from the gallows?
If I am hanged, it will be for ridding the world of an arrant rascal.
This hand will assist in the holder you deserve.
and throttle you, you dog!
Whiskey bar.
Where is my dear?
disown her. You see, the wench is distracted.
My kingdom, my virtue! Can I have no recompense? Sure, men are born to lie and women to believe them. Oh, vile villain!
Am I not your wife? You're ignoring me, your aversion to me just disproves it. Look at me! Tell me, am I not your wife?
Perfidious wretch, father of those virgins, and I'm quite close to your wife women and me.
No, your toast must cease for that.
Thank you.
now, wench!
Made you first suspect there was some truth in what I had said.
Indeed, my dear, I was strangely puzzled.
I would rather die than be false to thee.
How happy am I if you say this from your heart? For I love you so much, I'd sooner see you hanged than in the arms of another.
You could not bear to see me hanged.
Oh, Macheath, I could never live to see that day.
Oh, make me, if possible, love you more. And owe my life to thee!
My father, I know, has been drinking hard with the prisoners, and I fancy he's now taken a nap. I feel sure I can get the keys. Shall we then go off together, my dear?
Oh, if we lie entwined together, it will be impossible for us to remain concealed. Once the search for me cools off a little, I will send for thee. Till then, my heart is your prisoner.
Thank you.
proper woman. Lucy, if you weren't looked upon as such a fool!
But love, sir, is a misfortune that can happen to even the most discreet woman. And in love, we're all fools alike. Even after all his declaration, I'm now fully convinced Polly Peachum is his wife. Did I let him escape to go to her? Polly will wheel herself into his money, and then Peachum will hang him and cheat us both.
So I am to be ruined because you're in love?
To her he flies out. flat. Within the wiry grey, what guardians are we men? Every woman's easy prey, though we have felt the wound again. We bite and they betray.
Admit her, Brother Lockett?
By all means. She's a good customer, a fine-spoken woman, and a woman who drinks and gossips so freely that none of her customers' secrets are safe. She'll enliven the conversation.
Ask her to come in. You all right, Brother? Mrs. Trapes is always a great source of information. Oh, Diana, your servant! One can tell by your kiss that your gin is excellent.
Oh, I'm always very particular with my liquor.
Ah, that perfume breath. And I've long been associated with the flavour of those lips, haven't I, Lady Diana?
Watch our backs at all times.
man of private honest trade left in the land.
Oh, we run great risks. Great risks indeed. 5 of my sweetest girls have been laid low at the pox.
Oh.
What would the surgeons be? There are great goings out and no comings in. My girls cannot pay their commissions. Why, just today, one of my most lucrative lasses, Molly Brazen, has not given me remuneration for over 3 months.
Ah, sweet Molly Brazen.
Tragedy is all around us. So how do you cope with this betrayal?
Oh, I no longer buy clothes for these girls. I leave them naked. Let their customers provide their garments if they need attiring.
And what about sweet Molly?
Oh, well, just 2 hours ago, I stripped her of her clothes and left her waiting, as she ought to be, naked, for her captain.
Her captain?
Oh, if the captain should need, for his pleasure, a bodice or petticoat to ruffle, then tear asunder. Let him pay for them, that's what I say.
What captain?
Oh, an intimate acquaintance of yours, Mr. Peach. Captain MacEath.
Oh!
As large as life and fine as a lord.
Tiger, let me give you this gift of a nightdress for your own wearing. Are you sure it was Captain MacEath?
Thought I did not know him, but nobody knows him better. I've taken a great deal of the captain's money. A second hand from my ladies.
Mr. Lockett and I have a little business with the captain, you understand me. And we will fix up Molly Brazen's debt.
You can depend on it. We will acquit ourselves as gentlemen of honour.
Come, look it.
No!
I shall take some of these widow's clothes for my girls. The dear souls have great sensitivities, and on their clients hanging, like to be seen dressed in black at the gallows.
Thank you.
more money for another escape, for he is to be sentenced immediately.
Away, hussies! This is no time for a man to be hampered by his wives.
Thank you.
Keith's time has come, you see. We know what's best. Therefore, we'll have no more whimpering and wailing.
We must give up.
fell the strong and draws the stronger. The liquor we drink and the harder we feel. Our wars when we've lost the power of thinking. If a
some friends of yours, Captain. They want to be admitted.
We are heartily sorry for your misfortunes, Captain.
So am I. So am I, gentlemen. But look after yourselves so that you may live a few months longer.
It's true, lads. It's true. This is the place where one day we all must come.
Miss Polly and Miss Lucy request a word.
My dear Lucy, my dear Polly, what has passed between us is now at an end. The best advice I can give you is that you ship yourselves off to the colonies. You'll both have a chance of finding a husband. With a bit of luck, maybe two or three.
How can I bear this sight? There's nothing that moves one so much as a great man in distress.
Oh,
German captain with a child each. Here they come.
What, four more? Oh, this is far too much. Tell the sheriff's officers I'm ready to go now.